Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I begin in the name of Allah, the All-Beneficent, the All-Merciful. Nafsul Mahmoom, a heart-rending tragedy of Karbala by Sheikh Abbas Qummi. Chapter 25, Praise of the Battle of the Companions of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and their martyrdom. May Allah be pleased with them. Abul Hasan Sa'id bin Hibatullah, renowned as Qutubuddin Rawandi, relates through his chain of authorities from Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, peace be upon him, that before his martyrdom, Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, told his companions that his grandfather, the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and his pure progeny had told him, O my dear son, you shall be killed at Iraq, and it is a place where the prophets, their successors, and apostles have met one another, and it is called Amura. You shall be martyred at that place along with a group of your companions. Your battle is frigid and serene. Thus have glad tidings that by Allah, if they kill us, we shall go to the presence of our Prophet. Abu Hamza Somali relates from Imam Ali Zain al-Abidin, peace be upon him, that he said, On the night preceding his martyrdom, my father gathered his family and companions and said, O people of my family and my Shia, consider this night which has come to you as a mounting camel and save yourselves, for these people do not desire anyone else except me. Then if they kill me, they shall not pursue you. May Allah have mercy upon you. Save yourselves. Verily, I lift the responsibility of the allegiance and pledge which you have taken at my hands. Hearing that, his brothers, relatives and companions unanimously said, By Allah, O our Master, O Aba Abdullah, we shall never betray you, so that people may say that we had abandoned our Imam, our Chief and Master until he was martyred. Then we would seek excuses between ourselves and Allah, and we shall not leave you until we ransom ourselves upon you. Imam said, Verily, I shall be killed tomorrow, and everyone from among yourselves too shall be killed with me, and none among you shall be spared. To which they replied, Praise be to Allah that He has bestowed grace upon us to assist you, and has offered distinction to us to get martyred along with you. Then do we not endure that we should be along with you in your elevated station in paradise, O son of the Prophet of Allah? Imam replied, May Allah reward you favorably. Then he prayed for them. When it dawned, all of them were martyred. Sheikh Saduq relates from Salim bin Abu Ja'da, who says that I heard Ka'b al-Ihbar say that it is stated in our books that a man from among the sons of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him and his pure progeny, would be killed. And they, that is the martyrs, would enter paradise even before the sweat of the horses of his companions dry, while the houris will fondle them. Thus, when Imam Hassan, peace be upon him, passed by us, we asked him as to was he the one referred to regarding in their books, and he replied in the negative. And then when Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, passed by us, we asked him the same question, and he replied in the affirmative. It is related that it was inquired from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, peace be upon him, that please relate to us the state and the self-sacrifice of the companions of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Imam replied, The veil had been lifted off their eyes and they saw their places in paradise. Hence they excelled one another in sacrificing their lives so as to hasten to meet the houris and be fondled by them, and reach their places in paradise. This has been referred to in Ziyarat-e-Nahiya. After quoting the names of the martyrs, it is said, I bear witness that Allah lifted the veils of your eyes and presented you with spreaded beds and enormous gifts. It is related through successive chain of narrators in Ma'ani al-Akhbar from Imam Muhammad al-Taqi, peace be upon him, who relates from his blessed ancestors reaching Imam Ali Zain al-Abidin, peace be upon them all, who says that when the matter of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, turned severe, his fellow travelers saw him in a different state, unlike others. For as much as the severity increased, the color of their faces became pale and they would shiver, while their hearts would be frightful. But Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and some of his distinguished companions were cheerful, at peace and tranquil. They were telling one another, "Do you not see? They do not fear death the least." Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, said, "Forbear, O sons of noblemen. Death is nothing but a bridge which would take you from the place of hardship and severity to the spacious paradise and eternal bliss. Then who among you is such that does not desire to be free from the prison and hasten towards the palaces, while death for your enemies is such that they shall be transferred from the palace to the prison and fall prey to the wrath of Allah? I have heard my father Imam Ali, peace be upon him, who relates from the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, and his pure progeny, that he said that this world is a prison for the believers and paradise for the disbelievers, while death is a bridge for them, that is the believers, to enter paradise, and for them, that is the disbelievers, to enter hell. I have not lied, nor have I been told a lie." Regarding the pagans of Quraysh and their mutiny in astray and perdition, Allah says in the Holy Quran, "And indeed has come unto them some of the tidings wherein is restrained from evil, consummate wisdom, but they availed not of the warnings." Surah Qamar, verse 4 and 5. Similar was the case with the army of Umar bin Sa'd. Then the repeated speeches of our master Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and his companions, counseling them, completing their proofs to counsel them, and eliminating their error, but they were not benefited. Hur bin Yazid joins Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. When Hur saw that the people have resolved to kill Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and when he heard Imam calling out, "Is there none who would hasten to assist us in the name of Allah? Is there none who would defend the household of the Prophet?" Then Hur told Umar bin Sa'd, "O Umar, then will you really fight this man?" He replied, "Yes, by Allah, the battle which if goes smoothly will result in the rolling of heads and cutting of the hands." Hur said, "Then is his proposal unacceptable to you?" Umar replied, "If the situation would have been in my hands, I would certainly have yielded to his request, but your commander will not accept it." Hur then stood alone far away from others, while his fellow traveler named Qurra bin Qais was along with him. Hur said, "O Qurra, have you fed your horse today?" He replied in the negative. Hur said, "Then do you not desire quenching its thirst?" Qurra says that I doubted that perhaps he wanted to skip away from the battle and did not like that I should see him going away. Hence I said, "I shall now be doing so." Hearing this, Hur moved away from there. Qurra says that, "By Allah, if only Hur had revealed to me what he intended, I too would have accompanied him to the presence of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him." Then slowly Hur started moving closer to Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Muhajir bin Aws told him, "O son of Yazid, what do you intend? Do you intend to lay siege?" Hur did not answer him but was shivering. Muhajir said, "Verily your state seems dubious. I have never ever seen you in any battle in a similar state in which you are now. If I would have been questioned as to who is the most valorous among the Kufans, I would not hesitate to take your name. What is this state I presently see you in?" Hur replied, "I find myself between paradise and hell, and by Allah I shall not exalt anything else over paradise even if I be cut into pieces or burnt." Then Hur struck his horse Malhuf mentions and turned to go towards Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Hur had kept his hands on his head like a prisoner and was saying, "O Allah, I am returning towards you. Does you accept me? For I have put fear into the hearts of your friends and the children of the Prophet's grandson." As mentioned in Irshad and Kamil as well as Tabari, He says that when he neared Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and his companions, he overturned his shield and saluted them. Then he went to Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and said, "May I be your ransom, O son of the Prophet of Allah? I am the one who had stopped you from returning back and had accompanied you all along and had forced you to alight here. But I had not known that these people would directly refuse your proposal and bring you to this present state. By Allah, if I had known that they would do to you such, I would not have undertaken that what I have done. Hence, now I apologize to Allah regarding that what I have done. Then do you think that my repentance would be accepted?" Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, replied, "May Allah accept your repentance. Thus alight from your horse." Hur replied, "It is better for me to be mounted and serve you and fight with them. Thus ultimately I will have to alight from my horse when I am wounded." The Imam replied, "May your Lord have mercy upon you. Do as you desire." Then he stood in front of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and said, "O Kufans, may your mothers be deprived of you. You invited the righteous slave of Allah. Then when he came to you, you handed him over to the enemy when you had intended to defend him with your lives. Then now you have begun to fight with him so as to kill him. You have taken hold of him and seized his collar and have surrounded him from all sides so that he may not be able to escape to the vast towns of Allah. He is now left as a prisoner amongst you. Then he cannot benefit himself, nor can he ward off the evil from it. Then you have stopped him along with his women folk, his children and family from the water of Euphrates, which is open for the Jews, Christians and Sabians, and the pigs and dogs of Iraq rule therein, while they would perish because of thirst. How badly have you behaved with the progeny of Muhammad, peace be upon him, and his pure progeny after his death. May Allah not quench your thirst on the day of extreme thirst, that is Qiyamah." Hearing this, some of the soldiers attacked him and started shooting arrows at him. Then Hur came and stood in front of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. It is quoted in Tadhkira of Sibt ibn Jawzi that Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, then called out to Shabaz bin Rabi', Hajjar bin Abjar, Qais bin Ash'as and Yazid bin Hars and said, "Did you not write letters to me?" They replied, "We do not know what you say." Hur bin Yazid, who was their leader, said, "Yes, by Allah, we had written to you and we are the ones who have brought you here. Thus may Allah keep away vain and the vain doers. By Allah, I shall not prefer this world over the hereafter." Saying this, he turned his horse and entered the ranks of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Imam said, "Welcome. You are at liberty in this world as well as the hereafter." Ibn Nima mentions that it is related that Hur told Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, that when Ubaidullah commanded me to come towards you and I came out from the palace, I heard a voice calling out at me from behind saying, "Have glad tidings of goodness, O Hur." I turned around to see, but there was none visible. Then I wondered that, by Allah, what glad tiding is this? For I am proceeding to a combat with Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and I had not yet intended assisting you. Imam replied, "But now you have ultimately reached goodness." Then Umar bin Sa'ad called out, "O Duraid, bring the standard closer." When he brought it closer, Umar fixed an arrow in his bow and shot it, saying, "Be a witness that I am the one to shoot the first arrow." Then others followed suit and challenged for combat. Muhammad bin Abu Talib says that there was none among the companions of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, who was not wounded by it. It is said that after the rain of arrows, only a few companions of Imam, peace be upon him, survived, while 50 companions attained martyrdom. As mentioned in Tabari, Azdi says that Abu Janab from the clan of Bani Kalb related to me that in our tribe there was a man named Abdullah bin Umair from the clan of Bani Alim. He had started living in Kufa and owned a house on the head of the well of Bani Ja'ad, from the tribe of Hamadan. His wife, who was from the clan of Umr bin Qasit, was named Umme Wahab, the daughter of Abd. He saw an army parading in Nukhayla, preparing for the battle against Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, the grandson of the Prophet of Allah, peace be upon him, and his pure progeny. Abdullah says that, "By Allah, I had an intense desire to fight against the polytheists, but now I desire fighting those who have decided to fight the grandson of the Prophet, while my reward with Allah would not be less than that for fighting against the polytheists." Then he went to his wife and related to her what he had heard and also informed her his desire. She replied, "Verily, whatever you have decided is right. May your Allah guide you towards righteousness in all your matters. Go and take me too along with you." He then withdrew and reached Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and remained with him until Umar bin Sa'ad shot the arrows towards them and his army followed suit. Then Yasir, the retainer of Ziyad, and Salim, the retainer of Ubaidullah bin Ziyad, stepped into the battlefield and called out for combat. Hearing this, Habib ibn Mawahir and Burair bin Khuzair stood up to reply, but Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, signaled them to sit down. Then Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi stood up and asked permission to fight them. Imam saw him to be a tawny man with a tall stature, sturdy arms and broad shoulders. He said, "In my opinion, he is a fatal match. Then you may leave if you desire meeting his challenge." When Abdullah went towards them, they asked, "Who are you?" Abdullah related to them his lineage and they said, "We do not recognize you. Zuhair bin Qain, Habib ibn Mawahir or Burair bin Khuzair should have come." Yasir was standing with a naked sword near Salim. Abdullah said, "O illegitimate son, do you disdain fighting one man? Whoever shall come to fight you shall surely be better than you." Saying this, he attacked Yasir instantly and striking him with his sword killed him. When he was engaged in striking at him, Salim attacked him. Someone called out to him saying, "This slave is lingering behind you." Abdullah was heedless until Salim galloped upon him and he struck at him with his sword. Abdullah stretched his left hand forward, the fingers of which got cut. Then Abdullah attacked him and killed him. Then Abdullah recited the Rajas, having killed both of them. "If you do not know me, I am from the Bani Kalb. It is sufficient for me that my family is from Bani Ulaym. I am a warrior and a man with a strong nerve, and I am not the one who shrieks at the time of anxiety. O Umme Wahab, I am answerable to you in respect of the sword and spear of a man who believes in Allah." His wife Umme Wahab picked up a peg of a tent in her hand and advanced towards her husband calling out, "May my parents be your ransom. Fight in the way of the pure progeny of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him and his pure progeny." Abdullah advanced towards her to send her back to the tents, but she caught hold of his shirt and said, "I shall not leave you until I am killed along with you." Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, called out to her, "May you be rewarded fairly on account of the household of the Prophet. Return back. May Allah's mercy be upon you. Come to the ladies, for jihad is not obligatory upon women." Hearing this, she returned back. As mentioned in Irshad, Tawari and Kamil, Umr bin Hajjaj with his army attacked the right wing of the companions of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. When they came near, Imam's companions knelt down, pointing their spears towards them. Their horses were afraid to advance towards the spears and retreated back. Then Imam's companions shot arrows towards them, killing some of them while wounding others. As mentioned in Tabari and Kamil, a person from among the clan of Bani Tamim named Abdullah bin Hawza advanced further until he came face to face with Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and called out to him. Imam replied, "What do you desire?" The accursed replied, "May you get the good news of the hellfire, Allah's refuge." Imam replied, "No, it is not as you say. I am proceeding to the presence of the merciful Lord and the intercessor who is obeyed. Then he inquired as to who he was, and was told that he was the son of Hawdah. Imam said, O Allah, send him to the fire of hell. Suddenly his horse was aroused and threw him down, as mentioned in Irshad, but his left foot got entangled in the stirrup while his right foot was raised in the air. Then Muslim bin Awsajah attacked and cut his right foot. The horse started running with him, with his head hitting against the stones and trees of the desert until he died. Thus, his spirit hastened towards the fire of hell. As mentioned in Tabari, Azdi relates from Atta bin Sa'ib, who relates from Abdul Jabbar bin Wa'il, from his brother Masruq bin Wa'il, that I was along with the army who had advanced towards Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. I requested to be in the forefront so as to get the head of the Imam and thus earn honor in the presence of Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. When we reached him, a person from amongst us named Ibn Hawza advanced further and said, Is Hussein amongst you? But Imam did not answer him. When he repeated it thrice, Imam said, Yes, here is Hussein. What do you desire? He said, O Hussein, take glad tidings of hellfire, Allah's refuge. Imam said, Verily, you speak a lie. I am proceeding towards the forgiving Lord and an intercessor who is obeyed. Who are you? He replied that he was the son of Hawdah. The narrator says that then Imam lifted his hands towards the heavens such high that we could see the whiteness of his underarms from below his clothes and said, O Lord, hasten him towards the fire of hell. Hearing this, Ibn Hawza was enraged and desired to gallop his horse towards Imam, but there was a muat between them. Suddenly his foot got entangled in the stirrup and the horse dragged him until he fell off. Then his leg, peduncle and thigh separated, while the other half of his body lay suspended on the stirrup. Seeing this, Masruq returned and hid behind the horseman. The narrator says that I've questioned him, that is Masruq, regarding his return, and he replied that I have seen such wonders from this family that I shall never ever fight them. Martyrdom of Burair bin Khuzair. As mentioned in Tabari, thus the battle started. Azdi says that Yusuf bin Yazid related to me from Afif bin Zuhair bin Abi Akhnas, who was present at Karbala. He says that Yazid bin Ma'qal, who was from the tribe of Bani Umayra bin Rabia, which is a branch of Bani Salima of Abd al-Qais, came forward. He told Burair, O Burair bin Khuzair, do you see as to what Allah has done to you? Burair replied, By Allah, Allah has dealt fairly with me and has brought forth evil for you. Yazid said, You speak a lie and you never lied before. Do you remember once that when I was walking along with you in Bani Lawzan, you told me that Uthman bin Affan had killed himself while Muawiyah bin Abu Sufyan was a misguided man and the one who leads other astray, while the true and righteous Imam and guide is Ali bin Abi Talib? Burair replied, I bear witness that this is still my belief. Yazid bin Ma'qal said, I bear witness that you are among the astray. Then Burair said, Then do you desire that we imprecate one another while invoking the curse of Allah upon the one who lies? Then the one on the right path should kill the one who is upon the wrong. Then I shall come out to fight with you. The narrator says that both of them came out in the battlefield and lifting their hands invoked the curse of Allah upon the liar and that the righteous one should kill the evil. Then they started fighting one another. There were exchange of swords between them when Yazid bin Ma'qal dealt a light and ineffective blow on Burair. Then Burair dealt a blow upon his head which cut his head and reached his brain. He rolled down upon the ground like a ball while the sword of Burair was struck in his head and he was lifting it up and down to pull it out. Then Razi bin Manqas Abadi attacked Burair and grappled him. Both of them struggled until Burair threw him down and sat on his chest. Then Razi called out, Where are my defenders? Hearing this, Ka'b bin Jabir bin Umro Azdi advanced to assist him. When I said, This is Burair bin Khuzair, the reciter of the Quran who taught us the Quran in the mosque. He attacked Burair with his spear. When Burair felt the point of the spear, he threw himself upon him and bit his nose. But Kaab sunk his spear into him and drew it till his heart, while the entire point of the spear entered his back. Then he hit him on the head and started attacking him with his sword until he killed him. May Allah's mercy and blessings be upon him. Afif bin Zuhair bin Abi Akhnas says that it is as if I see Razi, who was scattered on the ground, arising while brushing off the dust from his cloak and telling Kaab that, O brother from the clan of Azd, you have favored me and I shall never forget it. Yusuf bin Yazid says that I asked Afif whether he had really witnessed it with his own eyes, to which he replied that, I have seen it with my own eyes and heard it with my own ears. When Kaab bin Jabir returned back, his wife and his sister, Nawar bint Jabir, told him, You have sided with the opponents of the son of Fatima and have killed the chief of the Quran reciters. By Allah, I shall never ever speak to you from now on. And Kaab bin Jabir recited the following couplets. You ask regarding me and shall be informed regarding the mourning of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. When the spears were being thrust that did not I commit the act which you despise, when it could not be imagined that day as to what I would do, I had with me my spear which did not falter and a white shining sword which was sharpened at the edge and fierce. Then I unsheathed it and attacked a group whose religion was not the same as mine, which was the obedience to the son of Harb. When I had not witnessed anyone similar to them in their age before them, who had fought fiercely in the battle, they are those who safeguard their honor. Then they bore patiently against the spears and swords and stepped into the battlefield. I wish this had profited them. Then when you meet Ubaidullah, give him this message, that I am obedient to the Caliph and compliant of his words. Then it is I who killed Burair and favored the son of Manqaz when he called for assistance. Martyrdom of Umro bin Qarta Ansari. Then Umro bin Qarta advanced and attacked while defending Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and he was saying, The battalion of Ansar knows that I am a protector of the territory of promise. I strike with a sharp-edged sword similar to a youth. Myself and household is lowly in front of Hussein. Your Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, is considered more than one's household. Thus vilifying Umar bin Saad, who while talking to Imam had said that my house shall be destroyed, etc., as mentioned in the earlier chapter of this book. Sayyid ibn Taus relates that after the martyrdom of Muslim bin Ausaja, Umro bin Qarta Ansari came forward and pleaded with Imam to permit him to go to the battlefield. When Imam permitted him, he attacked with such force which was similar to that of the one who yearns for paradise. Thus he strived to serve the Master of Heavens until he killed a group of people from the army of Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. There was no arrow which would advance towards Imam except that he stopped it with his hands. And there was no sword which would come towards Imam except that he took it upon himself. Then Imam did not receive any wounds until Umro was alive. When he was totally wounded, he turned towards Imam and said, O son of the Prophet of Allah, have I fulfilled my duty of obedience? Imam replied, Verily yes, you shall be the one to go to paradise before me. Then offer my salutations to the Prophet of Allah and tell him, that I am on my way following you. Then Umro fought bravely until he attained martyrdom. May Allah's mercy and blessings be upon him. As mentioned in Tabari and Kamil, it is related that Umro's brother Ali bin Qarta was in the army of Umar bin Sa'ad. When he saw his brother fall, he called out, O Hussein, O liar and the son of liar, Allah's refuge. You have misguided my brother and deceived him until you killed him. Imam replied, Allah did not mislead your brother. In fact, he was bestowed with guidance, while it is you who are misguided. The accursed said, May Allah kill me if I do not kill you or die while struggling against you. Saying this, he attacked Imam, and Nafi' bin Hilal al-Muradi came and stood facing him. Then he attacked him with a spear and threw him upon the ground. His companions came to his rescue and took him away. Then he treated his wounds and was cured. As mentioned in Tabari, Azdi says that Nazr bin Salih Abu Zuhair Abbasi says that when Hur bin Yazid went and united with Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, a man from Bani Tamim named Yazid bin Sufyan said, "By Allah, if my sight falls upon Hur, I shall kill him with my spear." When two armies were attacking and killing one another, Hur was attacking in the forefront while reciting the words of Antara. "With my charger's neck and breast, I will launch myself at them again and again until the beast is clothed in a blood." And he was reciting the following rajas: "I am Hur, a host to the guest. I strike your necks with a swift sword in defense of the one who has alighted at the ground of Khif in Mina, while I do not regret over it." The narrator says that the tail and brows of his horse were wounded by swords and blood was flowing through it. Hasin bin Tamim, the head of the police force of Ibn Ziyad, who had dispatched him to assist Omar bin Sa'ad and made him the commander of the police under the command of Yazid bin Sufyan, told Yazid bin Sufyan, "This is Hur bin Yazid, whom you desire." He then advanced towards Hur and said, "O Hur bin Yazid, do you desire combat?" Hur replied in the affirmative and he came towards him. Hasin said that, "By Allah, it is as if his life was in the hands of Hur, who instantly killed him." Hisham bin Muhammad relates from Abu Makhnaf, who says that Yahya bin Hani bin Urwa told me that on the 10th of Muharram, Hilal bin Nafi' was attacking while reciting the following couplets: "I am the son of Hilal. My religion is the religion of Ali. A man named Mazahim bin Hurais came towards him and said, 'I am upon the creed of Uthman.' Nafi' replied, 'However, you are upon the creed of Shaitan.' Saying this, he attacked him and ultimately killed him. Then Umro bin Hajjaj turned towards the army and called out, 'O foolish men, do you know whom you have been fighting with? You are fighting the valorous Kufans who are ready to sacrifice their lives. Thus, no one should go to fight single-handedly with them, for there are only a few left and a short time remains. By Allah, even if you attack them with mere stones, they shall perish.' Then Umar bin Sa'ad said, 'Verily, whatever you have said is true and his opinion is accepted.' Then he declared that no one should go for a single combat with them." It is narrated that Umro bin Hajjaj advanced towards the companions of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and said, "O Kufans, hold steadfastly to those who listen to you and your community, and do not hesitate to kill the man who has turned out of the religion and has disobeyed the Imam." Imam Hussein said, "O Umro bin Hajjaj, do you incite people against me? Have we turned away from the religion while you are steadfast upon it? By Allah, when you die with these evil deed of yours, you shall then know as to who has turned away from the religion and who is worthy of the fire of hell." Martyrdom of Muslim bin Awsaja. Then Umro bin Hajjaj attacked the right wing of the companions of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, along with the right wing of the army of Umar bin Sa'd, from the side of the Euphrates, and they fought for some time. Muslim bin Awsaja Asadi was the first one among the companions of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, to attain martyrdom. Then Umro bin Hajjaj and his companions returned back. As mentioned in Manaqib, it should be noted that Muslim bin Awsaja was the agent of Muslim bin Aqil, peace be upon him, in Kufa. He was given the charge to collect the funds, buy ammunitions and accept allegiance on behalf of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Muslim bin Awsaja fought valiantly in the Battle of Karbala while reciting the following rajas: "If you inquire about me, know that I am a male lion. I am from the chiefs and notables of the branch of Bani Asad. Thus, the one who oppresses us has deviated from the right path and from the religion of the self-sufficient, omnipotent Lord." He fought abundantly with the enemies and forbore upon the fight of the army until he fell down. The narrator says that when the clouds of sand sank, Muslim was seen smeared in blood. Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, went to his head when he was yet alive. Imam said, May your Lord have mercy upon you, O Muslim bin Awsaja. Of the believers are the men who are true to what they covenanted with Allah. Of them is he who fulfilled his vow, and of them is he who awaits its fulfillment, and they have changed not in the least. This is the verse of the Quran, Surah Ahzab, verse 23. Then Habib bin Mawahir came to him and said, It is very unpleasant for me to see you smeared in mud and blood, O Muslim. May you receive the glad tidings of paradise. Then Muslim replied in a soft voice, May your Allah give you glad tidings of fairness too. Habib said, If I had not known that I too would have to follow your path of martyrdom and reach you, it would have been my pleasure to ask you to will to me regarding your heart's desire until I fulfill the rites of your relatives and your co-religionists. Muslim replied, I recommend this master for you. He said, pointing towards Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Then you should ransom your life over him. Habib replied, By the Lord of Kaaba, I shall surely do that. It was not late when he died in their hands. May Allah's mercy and blessings be upon him. And one of his slave girls was heard calling out, O son of Awsaja, O master. The companions of Umar bin Hajjaj applauded, We have killed Muslim bin Awsaja. Then Shabbas turned towards his associates and said, May your mothers mourn over you. You kill yourselves with your own hands and are separating from your own selves for the sake of others. Then you are rejoicing because you have killed Muslim bin Awsaja. By him in whom I believe, I have seen him, that is Muslim, in the battlefield with honor for the Muslims. I have seen him in the battle in the plain of Azerbaijan at the time when no Muslim had moved from the places. He had already killed 6 polytheists. And when such a man dies, you rejoice over it. The murderers of Muslim bin Awsaja were Muslim bin Abdullah Zababi and Abdurrahman bin Abi Khashkar Bajali. Then Shimr attacked the left wing of the Imam's army. They stood in front of him and his army pushed them back with their lances. Then Imam and his companions were attacked from all sides and Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi, who had previously killed 2 men, was martyred. Hani bin Sabat Hazrami and Bukair bin Hay Tamimi killed him. May Allah's mercy and blessings be upon him, and he was the second martyr among the companions of Imam. Then the companions of Imam fought valiantly with the Kufan army. Their horsemen, being 32, attacked the Kufan army from all sides and splitted all of them. It is as if Abu Tufail says regarding them, What an army is this, similar to the waves, similar to the powerful beasts like leopards and lions. There are the old, the youth and the chiefs who are mounted upon the horses, escaping from whose midst is very hard. When the rays of the sun sets below their standard, its powers dim their eyes. Their slogan is similar to that of the Prophet, while their standards by which Allah the Beneficent avenges the schemers. It is as if it is said regarding them, astonishment that the clear-cut swords and spears see months in the hands of this group, and they are men, and astonishment that the fire burns upon their palms even though their hands are oceans. As mentioned in Tabari, when Urwa bin Qais, who was the commander of the horsemen, saw this situation that his horses were splitted from all sides, he sent Abdurrahman bin Hasin to Umar bin Sa'ad with the message that do you not see that since today morning my horsemen have been dragging along with these little group of men? Dispatch the foot soldiers and the archers towards them. Then Umar bin Sa'ad turned towards Shabbas bin Rabi and said, Will you attack Hussein? Shabbas replied, Glory be to Allah. Do you intend sending the chief of the towns and the master of the Kufans with the archers? Do you not find anyone else who could do this job? Shabbas disliked fighting Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Abu Zuhair Abbasi says that during the period of the caliphate of Mus'ab bin Zubair, I had heard him, that is Shabbas, say that Allah will never bestow goodness upon the people of Kufa and will not reach them towards felicity. It is not surprising that we fought in the ranks of Ali ibn Abi Talib, peace be upon him, and after him with his son Imam Hassan against the children of Abu Sufyan for 5 years. Then we pounced upon his son Hussein, who was the best from among the dwellers of the earth, and we fought against him in the ranks of the children of Muawiyah and the son of Sumayyah, the adulteress. Disgrace, and what a disgrace! Then Umar bin Sa'ad called for Hasin bin Tamim and dispatched him with the foot soldiers and 500 archers. They proceeded further until they reached Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and his companions. Then they shot their arrows towards them and impoverished their horses, and all of them came on foot. Azdi says that Namir bin Wahla relates from Ayyub bin Mashrah Haywani that he always said that, "By Allah, I was the one who impoverished the horse of Hur bin Yazid. I shot an arrow which pierced its belly. It gave a cry and rolled up itself on the ground. Suddenly Hur charged like a lion and leapt upon them with his sword in hand, saying, 'Even though you have cut off the legs of my horse, I am more valorous than a male lion. By Allah, I have not seen anyone like him who inflicted the ranks.' The chiefs of his clan asked him, 'Have you killed Hur?' He replied, 'No, by Allah, I have not killed him. Rather, another person had killed him, and I did not desire killing him.' Abu Wadaq asked him the reason, to which he replied, 'For he was included among the devout men. By Allah, if this deed of mine be a sin, then if I have to go to the presence of Allah with the responsibility of the injury and presence in the army, it is easy than that I go to his presence with the sin of their murder upon my neck.' Abu Wadaq said, 'You too shall go to the presence of Allah with the sin of their murder. Then tell me that if you pursued one of their horses and shot an arrow towards another, then you stood facing them and repeated this act of yours numerous times, and you encouraged your fellow army men. Then if you were attacked and you had to flee away with some of your companions, followed your example, resulting in the collaboration of you all with them in their murder, then all of you are equal partners in their blood.' Namir said, 'O Abu Wadaq, you are disheartening us from the mercy of Allah. Then on the day of Qiyamah, if you had been in charge of our accounts, may Allah not forgive you if you do not forgive us. It is better that we relate regarding them. Does this nation desire the intercession of the grandfather of Hussein on the day of Qiyamah after having murdered Hussein? No, never, by Allah. They will find no intercessor, and they will be engulfed in the wrath of Qiyamah.' As mentioned in Tabari, they fought with them valiantly until the noon. The Kufan army could not attack from any other side except one, because their tents were joined together. When Umar bin Sa'ad saw this, he ordered his men to attack the tents from the left and right sides, to dig them up and surround them. 3-4 persons from among the companions of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, stood up to guard the tents. Then they would attack the invaders from in between the tents, and whoever would come to dig the tent or plunder it would be killed, or they would shoot an arrow and injure him. Then Umar bin Sa'ad ordered, 'Do not go near the tents, nor dig or plunder them, rather burn them.' Then they burned the tents and held back their hands from digging or plundering them. Imam Hussein said, 'Let them burn the tents, for if they do so, the fire will act as a prevention against them.' It happened as said, and a group of them fought with them from one side. As mentioned in Tabari, the wife of Abdullah bin Umair Kalbi ran out into the battlefield and sat at the head of her husband, who was already martyred, as has been discussed earlier, cleaning the dust from him, and said, 'May paradise be pleasant for you.' When Shimr saw her, he commanded his retainer named Rustam, hit her upon the head. He dealt a blow upon her head, which split it open, and she attained martyrdom at that very spot. May Allah's mercy and blessings be upon her. Then Shimr bin Ziljawshan attacked until he reached a particular tent of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and striking it with his lance, said, 'Bring me fire so that I may burn it along with it contains.' Hearing this, the women folk started shrieking and came out of the tents in panic. Then Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, called out in a loud voice, saying, 'O son of Ziljawshan, do you ask for fire to be brought so as to burn the tent along with my family? May Allah burn you in the fire of hell.' Azdi says that Sulaiman bin Abi Rashid relates from Hamid bin Muslim that he said, that I told Shimr bin Ziljoushan, glory be to Allah, this does not suit you. Do you desire tasting the wrath of Allah by killing the children and ladies? By Allah, the commander will be pleased with you only with the killing of the men. Then Shimr asked me as to who I was, and I said, I shall not disclose who I am. I said this, for by Allah, I feared lest he would malign me in the presence of the sovereign. Then a man came to him whose orders he obeyed more than of Shabas bin Rabi, and said, I have not heard a more evil speech from you before, nor have I seen a more degraded situation that you have placed yourself in. Then have you now started frightening the women? I saw that hearing this, Shimr was ashamed of himself and retreated back. Then Zuhair bin Qayn attacked him and his companions with a group of his 10 companions until they had pushed them away from the tents, and they went far away and they killed Abu Uzra Zababi, one of the companions of Shimr. Seeing this, the entire army attacked them, putting them to loss. Many of the companions of Imam started falling down, and if one or two of them fell, their loss would be easily visible, while those of the enemies would not, because of the large numbers. Reminding for prayers by Abu Samama Sa'idi and the martyrdom of Habib bin Madahir. As mentioned in Tabari, when Abu Samama Umro bin Abdullah Sa'idi saw his companions being killed one after the other, he turned towards Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and said, O Aba Abdullah, may I be your ransom. I see that this army has advanced closer to you, but Allah willing, they shall not be able to kill you until they have killed us. And I desire that I go to the presence of Almighty Allah, having recited the prayers in your lead, whose time has already approached. The Imam lifted his head up and said, You have reminded the time of prayers. May Allah join you with the worshippers and the reciters, and verily, this is the prime time for praise. Then he said, Tell them to lift their hands off us until we have finished reciting the prayers. Hearing this, Hasin bin Tamim said, Your prayers are not accepted. Habib bin Madahir replied, You think that the prayers of the progeny of the Prophet of Allah is not accepted, while the prayers of you, a wine bibber, is accepted? Then Hasin bin Tamim attacked him, and Habib bin Madahir came to meet his challenge. Habib dealt a blow on the front of his head, which sank in, and Habib threw him down from his horse. Then his companions came to his rescue and took him away. Habib ibn Madahir then said, I swear that if we would have been similar to you in quantity or even half of that, you would have turned your back from us, O men of ill origin and importance. That day Habib was saying, I am Habib and my father is Madahir, who is a horseman of the battlefield when it is fierce. You are well equipped and large in quantity, but we are more obedient, forbearing than you. Our proofs are exalted while truth apparent, and we are more pious and pertinent than you. Habib ibn Madahir attacked severely, as mentioned in Malhuf, until he had killed 62 men. As mentioned in Tabari, then a man from the clan of Tamim attacked him and dealt a blow with his sword on his head and killed him. May Allah's mercy and blessings be upon him. The name of his murderer was Budail bin Sareen, who was from Bani Aqafan. Then another man from the clan of Tamim attacked him with a lance and threw him on the ground. When he tried to stand up, Hasin bin Tamim struck him on the head with his sword and he again fell down. Then the person from Bani Tamim alighted from his horse and cut off his head. Seeing this, Hasin said, I too am a partner in his murder along with you. To which he said, By Allah, no one except me has killed him. Hasin said, Then give me his head, so that I may hang it in the neck of my horse, so that people may see and understand that I too have participated in his murder. Then you may take it back and carry it to the presence of Ubaidullah bin Ziyad, for I am not desirous of the reward which he will offer you in lieu of murder of Habib. The man refused to do so until his people made him agree. Then he gave the head of Habib to Hasin, who hung it in the neck of his horse and started taking the rounds in the ranks and then returned it back. The Tamimi man placed the head of Habib on his horse and carried it to the palace of Ubaidullah bin Ziyad. The son of Habib named Qasim, who was nearing adolescence, saw the head of his father and recognized it. He followed him and went inside the palace and came out with him until his sight fell on him. He said, "O dear son, why are you following me?" The child replied that there was nothing. The person told him, "What is the matter? Tell me." To which the child said, "This head which is with you is that of my father. Give it to me so that I may bury it." The man said, "O dear son, the commander would not be pleased to its burial, and I desire that the commander reward me amply for this." The child replied, "But Allah will give you a bad punishment for what you did, for by Allah you have killed such a man who was better than you." Saying this, the child started weeping. Days passed by and the boy grew up. He had no other grief except to remain in pursuit of the murderer of his father, so as to get him unawares and revenge the death of his father. At the time of Mus'ab bin Zubair in the battle of Bajmira, this boy entered his army. He saw his father's killer in a tent and followed him and waited in ambush for him. He entered his tent when he was taking a nap in the afternoon, and striking him with a sword, killed him. Azdi says that when Habib bin Malahir was killed, Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, was bent. Then he said, "I surrender myself and my faithful companions to Allah's accountability." It is stated in some books of martyrdom, that is Maqatil, that the Imam said, "Your achievement is due to Allah, O Habib. You are a man of distinction that you completed reciting the entire Quran in one single night." Martyrdom of Hur bin Yazid. The narrator says that Hur started reciting the following rajas: "I have sworn not to be killed until I do not kill. Then I shall not be wounded except by advancing further. I will attack them with a sharp-edged sword. I shall not retreat back, nor will I flee from the battlefield." Furthermore, he recited the following couplets: "I am Hur, a host to the guest. I will strike your necks with a swift sword in defense of the one who has alighted at the ground of Khif in Mina, while I do not regret over it." He held such a sword in his hand whose edge was raining death. It is as if Ibn Mu'taz says about him, "I possess a sword which radiates death, then it is not unsheathed except that it starts spilling the blood." Hur, along with his companion Zuhair bin Qain, attacked, obviously. If while fighting one of them would get surrounded by the enemies, the other would come to his defense and rescue him. They continued doing so until the foot soldiers attacked Hur from all sides and killed him. May Allah's mercy and blessings be upon him. Ubaidullah bin Umr Badi, who was from the clan of Bani Kinda, says that, "Do not forget Sa'id bin Abdullah nor Hur, who along with Zuhair aided at the need of the hour." Fattal Nishapuri in his Rawzatul Wa'izin, while quoting the martyrdom of Hur bin Yazid, says that when Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, came to the head of Hur, blood was flowing from him. He said, "Well done, O Hur. You are at liberty in this world as well as the year after, as your mother has named you." Then he recited the following couplets: "What a best Hur is, the Hur of Bani Riyah, and the best Hur during the exchange of spears, the best Hur who was generous with regard to his life when Hussein called out in the morning." Sheikh Saduq too relates similarly from Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, peace be upon him. Sheikh Abu Ali in Muntahal Maqal says that Hur bin Yazid bin Najiyya bin Sa'id is from the clan of Bani Arbu. Sayyid Ni'matullah Jazairi Tustari writes in his Anwar-e-Nu'maniyah that a group of trustworthy men narrated to me that when Shah Ismail Safavi gained control over Baghdad, he came to visit the shrine of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, in Karbala. He heard some people vilifying Hur and hence came to the head of his grave and ordered it to be exhumed. People witnessed that Hur was sleeping in his grave, freshly drenched in his blood, and a kerchief was tied on his forehead. Shah Ismail tried to unfast the kerchief from his forehead, which according to the historical reports was tied by Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. When the kerchief was untied, fresh blood started pouring out until the grave was filled with it. Then, when the kerchief was tied at its place, the blood stopped. Then again they tried to untie that kerchief, but blood started pouring out. They tried to stop the blood by other means, but could not do so until they ultimately tied the same kerchief. Thus, the fine status of Hur was confirmed to them, and Shah ordered a mausoleum to be erected on his grave and appointed a servant to look after it. The Honorable Traditionist Sheikh Muhammad bin Hassan Hurre-Amili, the author of Wasa'il al-Shia, was from the progeny of Hur bin Yazid al-Riyahi, as has been quoted by Sheikh Ahmad in his Durrul Muluk. As mentioned in Tabari, Abu Samama Sa'idi killed his cousin who bore enmity with him and then recited the Zuhr praise in the method of Salat al-Khawf in Imam Hussein, peace be upon him's lead. Salat al-Khawf is daily prayer of a person which in war or similar circumstances is offered in a special and shortened way. As mentioned in Malhuf, it is stated in another narration that Imam told Zuhair bin Qain and Sa'id bin Abdullah to stand in front of him so that he may lead the Zuhr prayers. They did so while the Imam led the prayers with half of his companions. It is related that Sa'id bin Abdullah Hanafi stood in front of the Imam and thus became the target of their arrows. Wherever Imam would turn, Sa'id would stand in front of him until he was totally wounded and then fell down. He said, O Allah, send your curse upon them similar to the tribes of Ad and Thamud. O Allah, deliver my greetings to your Prophet and make him aware about the pain and wounds that I have borne, for I crave your reward while defending the progeny of your Prophet. Saying this, he breathed his last. May Allah's mercy and blessings be upon him. 13 wounds of arrows were upon his body, apart from the wounds of lances and swords. Ibn Nima says that some say that Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and his companions recited the prayers individually with signs. Tabari, Ibn Asir and others state that after finishing the Zuhr prayers, they attacked fiercely and neared Imam Hussein, peace be upon him. Then Sa'id stood armoring the Imam and defended him from all sides, thus becoming a target of the enemies. Arrows started coming from all sides until he fell down. It is written in the related salutations of the martyrs, peace be upon Sa'id bin Abdullah Hanafi, who, when Imam gave them permission to leave him, said, No, by Allah, we shall not leave you alone. Then you faced your death and defended your Imam and you witnessed the grace of Allah in the place of residence. May Allah gather us along with you in the ranks of the martyrs, and may Allah provide us your friendship in the exalted position of the Magnificent Ones. We say, reflect upon these words which prove the exalted status possessed by this felicitous martyr and other martyrs of Karbala, which is beyond the imagination of the intelligent ones, while this is enough proof of their grace. Ibn Nima too has related the martyrdom of the above referred Sa'id in the words of Tabari and Ibn Asir. Then he says that then Umar bin Sa'ad sent Umro bin Hajjaj with the archers. They shot arrows towards the remaining companions of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and killed their horses. The situation reached such that Imam had no horsemen left with him. And he said, Will the young horses be under the banner of others besides us, when we are the chief of their martyrs? Then when a calamity desires entering our town, we possess the power to turn it away. No one walks in the width of the porch with a shining sword, and none from among our group guards him. As mentioned in Tabari, Zuhair bin Qain fought valiantly and he was saying, I am Zuhair and I am the son of Qain. I will bar you from Hussein with my sword, for he is the one of the two grandsons of the Prophet who is a virtuous and chaste progeny. There is no lie that he is the Prophet. I shall kill you and shall not regret over it. And I wish myself could be divided into two, so that I may fight with you twofold. As mentioned in Tabari, then Zuhair placed his hand upon the shoulder of Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, and said, Proceed further, for you are a guided one and are a guide. Today you shall meet your grandfather the Prophet and Imam Hassan and Murtada Ali, peace be upon him, and a well-equipped young man with two wings, Ja'far, your uncle, and Hamza, the alive martyred lion of Allah. As mentioned in Maqtal of Muhammad bin Abi Talib, then he attacked until he killed 120 men. As mentioned in Tasliyatul Majalis, Tabari and Kamil, then Kasir bin Abdullah Sha'abi and Muhajir bin Aus Tamimi attacked him and threw him upon the ground. May Allah's mercy and blessings be upon him. When Zuhair fell down from his horse, Imam Hussein, peace be upon him, said, O Zuhair, may Allah not keep you away from himself, and may Allah send his wrath on your killers as he did to those who were turned into monkeys and pigs.